For centuries, women have been redefining the rules that society has set forth. What's allowed, what's proper, what's possible. Every generation builds on the work of those that have come before. She carries on the legacy while leading the future. Refusing to be contained, she expands her identity. The boss, the breadwinner, the caregiver, the lover, the fighter. The era no longer defining her, she defines the era. As the co-founder and CEO of an activewear empire, you are not only empowering women through their wardrobe, but redefining the way we think about work and well-being. You have said that starting a business has always been a passion project. So how did the idea for Carbon38 initially come about?
I was a professional ballet dancer. I grew up dancing ballet since the age of 4. Went to college, worked on Wall Street very briefly, deferred a full-time offer to dance on Broadway and to dance in national tours, and I became a fitness instructor. I have to say, you know, this was 2007 when I first started teaching fitness. I just fell in love with my customer. In the last 10 years, there has been a shift in the lives of women, and the demands on women are truly unprecedented. No longer are we just having to enter the workforce, we have to win. We're also the primary caretaker, so we're the ones that get the call when little Sally's sick at daycare, when we're in the middle of a board meeting. Just think about getting dressed in the morning, that first decision you make. We have to decide what heel height, what lipstick shade, what blouse, are we wearing our hair up or down? I mean, it's those micro decisions that are really meaningless, but so impactful for your day. We have to walk into work after making all these decisions, looking fabulous and winning against all odds. I fell in love with this spirit, and so I knew I needed to serve her for the rest of my life. I created Carbon38 for her, and what's really cool is when we started in 2013, it was all about sports bras and leggings. And if you think about your favorite pair of leggings, you throw on, you walk into the gym, and you outperform your expectations, there's an emotional connection that is formed to that piece of clothing. I wanted to create that feeling not just for the hour at the gym, for the rest of her life. And what's been awesome is we've been surfing this wave that activewear is becoming trendy outside of the gym. You know, it's no longer ridiculous to wear leggings to brunch. It's actually quite fashionable. And so it's just been this amazing evolution.
Athleisure is expected to be an $83 billion market in the US by 2020. Yet when you started, you were actually way ahead of the curve. Launching a company is, of course, no easy task. What were some of your early challenges and how did you overcome them?
A couple of friends, all former ballet dancers, got together. We went up to a startup weekend, which is pitch an idea, assemble a team, build a minimum viable product, all within 54 hours, and then pitch to venture capitalists. It was like a room full of Facebook and Google engineers and me in my leggings. I stood up on stage saying I was this celebrity trainer and I had this vision for creating a marketplace and a unified platform for the wellness industry. We built a minimum viable product, which is really just a splash page with a bunch of email signups. We played it on the big screen as our demo and we ended up winning a prize. Initially, we launched as a content site, kind of like Into the Gloss, which had a gym bag edit. Instead of looking at a supermodel's medicine cabinet, we were looking at an influencer, a trainer, a celebrity's gym bag to make those products available for sale. We did some cross-dock, we did some dropship, we did all sorts of ways because we didn't have any cash, really. And we just started testing and creating these contextualized, beautiful stories around wellness. And I started seeing the only thing she was really clicking on were leggings. We were sending cosmetics and they would explode on transit. Everything that went wrong could, except the leggings were great. They just sat on a shelf somewhere, they didn't expire, and I could ship them out and they packed flat, but the customer was really into it. And what was really cool is suddenly there are these female-founded brands designing for themselves, designing for women, and they didn't have a way to break in because no department store would carry active yet. It was too expensive to open up a whole slew of stores and compete against Lulu. To have the marketing budget of Nike, it was impossible, so I thought, why not stitch it together? Why not create this big net, and then let's go after the big guys? Today, you know, we're working with over 200 vendors from all over the world, 75% of which are female-founded, which I'm so proud of. And the dream is to take on the big guys, and we will.
You know, as women, it feels like we've been tied to some pretty traditional standards when it comes to workplace attire. You are totally redefining this. So what is your vision for the future?
It's so interesting what a traditional industry looks like at the precipice of change. We have to understand what fashion really is. Fashion is such a voice and such a form of expression. For centuries as women, we have been dressed either to disappear or as decoration. Any rules in general are made up. Our corporate attire rules are made up. So we can just rewrite the rules. I'm not even gonna pay credence to those old rules that we as women have to wear heels and pantyhose and French twists to show up in a boardroom. Because I have a board meeting in 2 days and I'm definitely wearing high tops and a cool sheer jacket and my hair is gonna be in a bun and I probably am not gonna have any makeup on and I'm gonna feel like a baller. And that's just how I should show up. I truly believe the key to gender parity is financial independence. So I wanna be a baller, I wanna have a team of ballers and I wanna have an ecosystem of ballers that we're just helping crush it every day. It's up to this generation to just finally take us across the finish line to gender parity. Nothing that we can do, no more that we can break through.
Once it started pumping, pushing the wheeling. Not only do you curate the world's best activewear brands, you've also created your own hugely popular collection. What did you learn from your customers in terms of what might be missing from their wardrobe?
The challenge always was, how do we start our own collection without interfering with all of these amazing vendors? Because first and foremost, we are a multi-brand retailer. We are a curator. We also saw white space. And so it just felt like the perfect time to enter the market. I think our first collection is quite symbolic of our overall private label strategy, where we had basics, so like basic beautiful black leggings, all the way to a neoprene pencil dress and matching blazer that you can wear to work. That's really where I see the opportunity. So we're not stepping on anyone's toes and we're building a full edit where the Carbon38 customer can rely on us for everything from A to Z. I think that this next frontier for Carbon's own branded label is what the future of fashion looks like and how can we better serve her for every hour of her day. Being able to think through that, it just reminds me of the constant connection to the consumer. And it's the one time where I forget about our KPIs and I really am thinking about how she's gonna feel. Because when you feel good in your clothes, you can conquer the world.
Reflecting back on your incredible journey, what has been the biggest lesson you've learned that has really helped shape the leader that you are today?
I think it's a bit of the death by a thousand paper cuts, to be honest. It's just the constant barrage of issues. It's like whack-a-mole all day long. And if you're not ready for that, it can just take you out at the knees. I've had to learn that the waves of challenges will always be there. And it's ultimately, how do you respond? I think the best leaders are the ones that know how to actually make that the fun part of their job, is like, what's next? What's next? Bring it. If things are going well, you're not learning anything. You're just feeling great. You're feeling fly. In times of stress, you grow. As a result, I believe we're athletes. We are training for the Olympics. The headwinds are strong and hard, but I think all that's doing is honing and sharpening our skills to go and take that winner's trophy. I read a great quote the other day and I wish I could attribute it. They said, an entrepreneur is someone who will do the work that most won't so that they can live the rest of their lives like most won't. Oh, it's gonna be hard. It's so much harder than you think, ever. But it's so worth it. That's what I was put on this earth to do. And I have no other choice. An entrepreneur out there feels that, you'll know it. You can't do anything else. There's nothing else in this world you can do, and so it's all gonna be worth it. No harm from home can keep us down.
We hold the line. Within us all lies a reservoir of resilience, deep enough to pull us through the darkest of days and the strongest of storms, a force to push back and fight on. The source that helps us hold the light for everyone around us. Because when one of us digs in and digs deep, it reminds us that we too can shine bright.